So MIS Chapter 12, Management Support Systems. This is a pretty interesting chapter for those interested in business. Let's see what we have here. So the learning outcomes of this chapter are, like, what are some of the phases that a decision maker goes through? And what are some of the kinds of decisions that are made? So we're going to see what kind of systems we can develop that'll help managers. What is a decision support system? What are some of the things that an EIS or executive information system can do? What are some group support systems like we're all getting familiar with Zoom and things like this? What are some of the things we can do with a geographic information system or a GIS? And what are some of the steps we would go for designing one of these? So this is a very theoretical chapter, and this is designed mostly for, of course, business majors, and let's see how computers can help in business. So in most organizations, and I'll pick either a grocery store chain or somebody making cars around the world, or maybe somebody doing pension investments, some decisions we make are very structured. Let's say at a grocery store, if things arrive on a truck, somebody has to make a very quick decision. Do we accept them? Do we take them into inventory? Or do we send them back? And then there's some are very basic, and we can program these tasks. Some are less structured, or let's say semi-structured. So these have some guidelines in them, but also we have to make some human decisions as well. So some of this, but the more structured a decision is, the more easy we can write a program to make an automatic response. And less and less, so basically the higher you go in an organization, the less structure there is. So a lot of times, you know, should we merge with another company? We can't just write a program for that. Should we hire this person as an executive? Should we change our pension plan? So that's why sometimes the top level people do get paid extra money, because we look at their intuition. So basically the less structure there is in a decision, the more human input we need. So part of this chapter's goal is to see what kind of systems can we create or use that'll help in our decision-making process. And I have several that I've used in my life that I think will be good examples. So there are some real challenges here. That the more semi or unstructured it is, we have multiple criteria, things changing. And there's different objectives. Some people want to grow a company, some people want to simplify. It's just like another example that we use is your investment decisions in your life. Sometimes we want to grow. Sometimes we want less risk, simplify. So this graph you'll see in any one of these books for a business class, basically the higher you go in an organization, the less structured the decisions you are involved in. We're looking at things maybe multiple years out, maybe information from overseas. And the lower we are in an organization, the more structured things are. Okay, I get something coming in. I get a bill coming in. Then I have to put it into accounts payable. Or somebody's paying me, I debit that into accounts receivable. So the lower an organization, the easier it is to have our tasks programmed away from us. That's another way of looking at it. So we're looking at this week, management support systems. What kind of information systems that can really help you make decisions. For example, for an airline, maybe if I need to have a certain number of passengers booked for a flight to occur. If I don't hit a certain number, that flight gets canceled. But only if there's a rollover possible with another flight scheduled within whatever. I'm just making this up. A two-hour time period or a three-hour time period. So we may say, well, it's better to we save more money by giving these passengers, even if we give them a $100 gift coupon or something. Again, a management support system would help us make those decisions. Now we're at a car dealership. Should I order more cars, knowing that it takes multiple weeks to get here? But maybe my management support system says, every year, this time of year, we get multiple orders. Therefore, if we don't have cars on inventory, they'll go to our competitor. Those are the kinds of things we want the systems to help us with. So in any decision-making, especially when we're trying to see what can we computerize, there are certain phases. In this intelligent phase, what the heck are we doing? You know, we have to learn about the business that we're in at this phase. And then once we understand that, we can design some kind of a system to help us. And then we actually narrow down to several choices. then do we implement them or not? I'll use an example along the way that I was doing of which investment, say apartment buildings to buy or condominiums as an investment. I'll use that because it's not that easy to make a decision, but if somebody who's done that a lot has put together a model, maybe that can make your life a lot easier. So the decision makers, we need to know what really is our environment. What are the conditions we need to know? If it's cars, maybe we look at what's going on with global unemployment or oil prices or tariffs and just the things happening around the world. Prices of metal. There's so many different factors, but that's, again, we need to get our intelligence and then figure out what data to get and where to get it from. In the design phase, so what are the criteria for the decision? What are some of the alternatives? Again, back for me, I was trying to make decisions whether to buy or not buy certain condominiums or small apartment buildings like a triplex and fourplex. So I had to understand what are the criteria, you know, what are the variables, what's their rent, what's the desirability of the location, what's the expected ongoing annual costs, and based on some factors, you could kind of have a system help lend you towards a purchase or non-purchase decision. And so some of this, the IT does not really help you design it. We're trying to design systems that IT can help us with. Okay, so now we say, what's the best and most effective course of action? We want to come up with systems. Let's say it's an investment. So I've got many, many stocks to pick from. Well, this can maybe help me do stock picking. So the system maybe look through possible solutions and it'll say, well, look, this has a great price to earnings ratio, or this stock has been paying dividends. So I would absolutely think there's many decision support systems to help investors where to put my money based on certain factors. Again, how long till you plan on retiring, or is your, what is your goal? Is to, you're a company, you're trying to have a safe pension fund, or are you trying to maximize investment, or what's the goal? Or only invest in green companies, who knows? And so then we actually, this decision support system will help create a plan for carrying out our alternatives. So what is this? What is a decision support system? It's really a combination of hardware and software that's trying to assist the decision maker. And as I say, here was a sample I personally did. I had an investment property analysis. Well, I have a friend who has made a lot of money, and he's, what he's done over and over again is what I was just kind of getting started with. He would buy rental units. For him, it was mostly fourplexes and up. They didn't start that way, but now, for a variety of reasons, those can be more profitable. Triplexes and fourplexes and apartment buildings. But he had a wonderful decision support system. All it was a model made with Excel. And you put in variables such as what does it cost to buy the place, what's my property tax, what's my projected rent, rents per square foot, what kind of other things, like he would not get properties that have pools, for example, and I learned that too. That's just, you don't get more rent, but you have more expense. Pools are great for your own home, but not for a rental unit. And so many, many other variables. And when we plug all the variables in, the data that we could come up with, this would spit back a number, and he wanted it to be over a certain number to make it a good investment. So there's always some variables. Maybe I can negotiate a better price, then the numbers would go up. Maybe I could raise my rents. Again, we're looking at it from the perspective of the landlord. But that's a really simple decision support system. Years ago, I was hired at a university in Oregon, Oregon Institute of Technology, to teach decision support science, DSS. And all that was glorified Excel modeling. So these things, the requirement for these is that they are interactive, that we should be able to enter some data, and a lot of it can be internal data, like what's the numbers from our own company, how fast can we produce cars or whatever it is, comparing with some external data, like what's the current interest rate, what's the projected employment rate. And there's, again, in the larger ones in the world, mathematical models, statistical models. Heck, at the time of this recording, the coronavirus is being modeled up and down, and a lot of variables that different decision makers at different levels may be getting different data. So, and some of that's structured, some of that is unstructured. So decision support systems are all about trying to get computerized systems to help a decision maker make a good decision. And let's pause and call that the end of part one.